Welcome.
Good morning.
We are here for another phenomenal Couples Academy show. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
My name is Sasani.
I'm Danielle.
And we are Couples Academy. And if you don't know who we are or what we do, we are a private practice that works for couples all over the world to help them have better relationships. So if you've been experiencing crisis in your relationship, if you're on the verge of divorce, if you've gone through some type of struggle and you want to know how to overcome it, you want to give us a call at 678-200-8996. We're Couples Academy. Set up that discovery call and let's get started today. I'm excited because we're approaching the end of the year. And as you know, during the end of the year, that's when people are in the valley of decision about what they're going to do regarding their marriage. And people are contemplating, do I want to move into the next year in this situation? Do I want a fresh start? Do I want to, I don't know, work to see if anything can change and transform? And I'm excited because that's when the phone really starts ringing and we get to really help impact people's lives.
Yeah, it's a phenomenal opportunity for you to pivot because we get to the end of the year and oftentimes we start thinking about the new year resolution, but we've got all this year left over to make a big change and look at what's going on and figure out how we can set ourselves up for a great next year. So if you're struggling in your marriage and you're not certain about what you need to do, how you need to move over, you need to book a call. They are free. It's a free discovery call, 678-200-8996. I'm really excited about today's conversation because we're continuing with this series on the victim mentality. And today we are talking about 10 signs of the victim mentality. Join us now.
Yeah, we're talking about a victim's mentality. Yesterday, we started that conversation and it was pretty good because we were talking about the benefits of being a victim and how so many people win. There are benefits to doing so.
It's one of the reasons why we don't make the choice to heal and to move forward, because if I have to make that choice to heal, then I've got to give up being able to complain, point the finger, and not be culpable or responsible for my part in anything, or be responsible for my own happiness. And the truth is that you are responsible for your own happiness. The truth is that none of us are born with a victim mentality, just like you're not born with depression and you're not born with anxiety. These are personality traits that we acquire along the way. And if you are in tune, you can make some shifts so that you can control your happiness.
And so we're ready to get into this conversation. But before we do, we always want to say good morning.
Good morning. To some okay, of who the we got? Good morning, Tay, Timothy, Michelle, Gigi, Rhea, Corinne, Tapel. These are some interesting names. I think we got people from all over the world. Hey, Stephen. Hey, Calvin. Good morning, my brother. Jay and Angel. Welcome, everybody. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. It's really important for you to do that because guess what? Even though we're broadcasting internationally and all over the place, people can get on the Couples Academy show. Not everybody knows about it yet. And so you have everything to do with making that happen. So make sure you share it with your friends and family.
And we're also taking calls. So if you want to call in, as we said before, we're transitioning. We want to be a call-in show and really interact with you. So you can call now at 678-200-8996 and we will talk to you. But let's get into today's topic. There's a lot to talk about. We're talking about the 10 signs. We may cover a little bit more, but the 10 signs of a victim mentality. And we just want to get started. Number one, you're constantly blaming other people or situations for your misery. See, we have a tendency of pointing the finger at everyone else and everything else, not realizing that there are fingers pointing right back at us. And so at the end of the day, you are the lowest common denominator in your life, in your relationship, in every situation that you experience. And you've got to be able to self-assess and to look at you and to say, how did I get into this situation? How have I contributed to where I am today? If you haven't done that, then you may be suffering from a victim's mentality.
You know, I think we all know somebody who has that victim mentality, that everything is everybody else's fault. they are the most difficult couples to work with because we can't get them to see past their own issues. We can't see get them to see that, hey guys, you have all the responsibility in the world. It's up to you to make the change. You have full control over your future. You may not have control over your past, right? Because a lot of things that have gone on, when somebody mentioned this yesterday, basically saying that, well, it's maybe not a victim mentality. Maybe it's that I'm actually really hurt. Real talk, we get hurt like throughout our lives. Our parents have raised us in a certain way and some of that has hurt us. Friends, family along the way, circumstances, life crisis, everything. Things happen that are outside of our control that hurt us. The thing that we do have control of is how we move forward after that. Hassani said it perfectly yesterday. If somebody punches you, knocks you down to the ground, it's his fault. He punched you. But if you stay there, it's your fault.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Jaguar says, I try repeatedly to heal and move on. And I need my glasses and not give in to a victim mentality. But my spouse kept reoffending. I kept being re-victimized, so I couldn't heal. I could never reach my wholeness. And so, listen, guys, it's important that even within the realm of your relationship, if you feel like your spouse is offending and victimizing you and attacking you, you can place healthy boundaries around yourself to prevent certain behavior. At the end of the day, now, understand what I'm saying. Your spouse is responsible for what he or she does, but sometimes we're complicit. Sometimes we go along with it. You've got to make decisions within yourself about what's good for you, what you're willing to accept and what you're not. And this is where hard decisions come in. Oftentimes we're waiting for our partner to make a change while we remain the same. And it is not until you make an internal vow within yourself about what you're going to accept and what you're not. It is not until you make a change for yourself will your situation begin to change. We know that we can't do anything about what other people attempt to do. They may be verbally abusive. They may attempt to be physically abusive. But at the end of the day, what are you going to do about your situation?
Yeah. And unfortunately, if you're in a toxic relationship and you begin to build those walls around yourself, because that's what we do naturally. We've talked about that a lot. We start to build up these protective walls so that I can see out, but you can't see in. There's no intimacy. There's no connecting. You can't touch me. You can't get within 10 inches of me. Well, now I'm emotionally disconnected from you. I'm blocking you. And so that's not necessarily a healthy place to be, but sometimes it's what we have to do to cope while we're working with a situation. Toxic relationships exist, and that's not a situation that you want to plan to stay in. You want to fix that toxic relationship before you, or figure out a way that maybe you're not going to move forward with that person. I mean, we're not into that, but at the end of the day, sometimes these toxic relationships are unresolvable by you. And so there are consequences.
Anthony says, at the end of the day, you teach people how to treat you. I think there's a lot of validity in that.
So true.
You know, listen, once again, if somebody is expressing a behavior that you had nothing to do with, that's all them. They have to own their decision. But if it continues on, like we've known people who have been relationships for years that have stayed in physically abusive relationships. And the question is, well, why are you still I'm confused. Okay. Now I got to talk to you. What is it that would make you stay in that situation? So a lot of times people need the strength, right? And the courage and the boldness and the audacity. That's why we call our book The Audacity of Marriage. You need the audacity to do something different to change your situation.
New perspective, because I mean, everybody has seen that dog in the backyard. His tail is between his legs. He stopped waving his tail a long time ago, right? He's chained to something and he's just sad down and low. Well, he's an abused dog. And a lot of times you need somebody to help you shift your perspective so that you have some belief in the possibility of change. I think that's where a lot of people get stuck in these relationships that are abusive.
Right. I think we have I think somebody's trying to call. Wait, hang my phone up. Hang my phone up. See, this is what happened, guys. We're trying
it's
to
a
go
live. Show.
Anyway, let's go to the next one. You see your problems as catastrophes and blow them out of proportion. And that's another thing where you take little molehills and you make them mountains.
It's called catastrophizing the situation, man, when it's a tiny situation. It's not that serious. Have you ever had anybody said that to anybody? It's not that serious. It's going to be okay. Calm down. But if you're the type of person that blows it out of the water, makes a scene over every situation, big or small, because your need is for that desire and to be the victim. We all know those people. We've all experienced those people.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. So if that's you, come on now. You may be suffering from the victim's mentality. Mm-hmm. Listen, you think other people are purposely trying to hurt you. That's another sign of a victim mentality. See, you often question the intent and the motive of a person's behavior. And it's just like, that was not what I was trying to do. Like, why are you perceiving this the way? And so it goes back into your mindset. It goes back into the lens through which you look that's evaluating and interpreting what somebody's doing. So sometimes we have faulty assumptions. Sometimes we attach different meanings to people's behaviors than what they personally meant. As people are communicating with us, they're encoding a message, but we are decoding what it is that they're saying. And if we're looking and listening through past hurts and past pains and unresolved issues, we may interpret something that's really not what the reality is. Mm. And so this causes us to stay in that type of victim's mentality. Here's a powerful one. Now, I want you to listen to this. You are suffering from a victim mentality if you keep reliving the past painful memory that made you feel like a victim in the first place. We talk about time travel. Folks, time travel is real. You can travel into your past. You can travel into your future. Well, how? Is there a time capsule? Yes, it's called the mind, because the mind is a record of the past and a roadmap into your future. And so every time you go back to that past event, it can re-traumatize you. You begin to experience that pain and suffering all over again as if it just happened. And when you park there and you build residence there, then you can remain victimized, yes, constantly, because of what
now
was done in the past.
Now hear what he's saying. He's saying if you remain there, if you park there, if you build residence there. So this does not discount real live triggers that people are experiencing, real hurt, real pain, things that are at this time out of their control, because a lot of things at certain times are out of their control because they're going through something, right? But the key word is going through, right? If you're walking through a hallway, you're not stagnant. You don't sit there. You keep on walking. And I think that's the big deal. When people stay stagnant in their situation, that's when they become victimized. I hear a lot of people that have been through terrible things. Matter of fact, years ago, I worked with this guy who was from like Senegal or something. And he told me this crazy story about how he got to America. They like walked, they swam, they went through jungles. They did all this stuff that was just outside of any realm of normalcy to get away from people that were murdering them. And I thought, oh my God. But he would always say, but I'm not a victim. I'm blessed. I made it to America. All of that made me strong. See, he didn't have a victim mentality. So this doesn't discredit what you're going through, because when you're going through all kinds of hell and high water, it's a terrible thing, but go through.
Absolutely. Listen, we got more comments. Heather says, yes, you are doing great with the love show. Not a typo. This is definitely a mindset from childhood abuse. You learn to scan a room for everyone else's feelings. This adjusts your behavior in order to not get hurt again. We have to learn that our emotions are important also. Very, very true. And then yes, we have from Anthony, amen. Stop relitigating the past. Let go and let God.
Right on.
What a powerful
right
statement
on,
to
right
say.
On, yes.
So let's go to the next one. Listen, you feel attacked when you're given constructive criticism. So listen, you are not perfect. You don't have it all together. There are some idiosyncrasies, some inconsistencies, some contradictions, faults and flaws, weaknesses, vices, behaviors that you can work on to become your best self. But when somebody tries to offer constructive critique, you become highly offended. How dare you? Who are you to tell me? And our walls go up because we're struggling with ego and pride, or we have a fragile self-esteem and can't hear and can't even contemplate and think about what somebody's saying. It literally attacks our self-image. If I think that I'm this wonderful person and you have the audacity to think otherwise, it literally can destroy people. They can't handle it. And you have to realize, listen, You are not where you used to be, but you're far from where you need to be. And you're still on your process and you're still on your growth track. And so listen, sometimes you have to have people in your life who can be honest with you and real with
That's
you.
That's real.
If all you have are cheerleaders, yeah. then you're setting yourself up for a fall.
One thing that's really great to do is get around some real people that know you and just do a roundabout and have an open dialogue. Like, tell me what's wrong with me. I know there's a lot of great things about me. I know you like me, but tell me what's wrong. Tell me what I could work on. Those are some of the most powerful talks. We've done that with our circle quite a few times, and it's really insightful. Not always easy to hear, but it's powerful to hear the insight from other people because you're looking out, okay? You're only looking outside of you. You don't see how you're showing up and how you're impacting everybody else. So it's a powerful thing to do, to just become aware of your own issues.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Here's another powerful one. This is a great sign of a person who struggles with a victim's mentality. You believe that you're not responsible for what happens to you in your life. So in essence, you've placed the responsibility on everyone else. And that keeps, basically what you're doing is you're giving away your power and you are empowering other people, other situations, other circumstances for determining your life. And we see that even with the election. Think about it. Like, our entire lives are hinged upon who becomes the president. But there's a particular personality we listen to, and they said, listen, Biden won. We'll see what happens because this election is crazy. Who knows? But they said, even if Biden won, Biden's not going to read that book for you. Biden's not going to take that class for you. Biden's not going to develop those skills for you. So whether you voted for Biden, whether you voted for Trump, your life cannot be determined by who's in office. You've got to determine what you're going to do with your own life. Even with the pandemic, like literally it has shifted things and has put life on hold for many people. And there's all of this uncertainty. And you know what? We're just going to sit back and wait around till the circumstances change before we figure out what we're going to do. No. You have to take the power back into your own life and determine what you're going to do regardless of what's happening around the world. If you don't have a plan for your life and for your family, and you're waiting for the government to have one, you're waiting for your school system to have one, you're waiting for your pastor to have one, you're waiting for everyone else to have one, that is a sign that you're a victim in terms of your mentality.
Yes. Wow. We have a comment from Kayana. Hey, Kayana. It says, who and what determines if it's a big or small issue? And I think that's a good question because it could be your spouse if you're healthy. Mm-hmm. If you're unhealthy and there's issues within the marriage, then it probably shouldn't be your spouse. But think about this. When you're at a job and you're going in for the review, right? Your boss sits you down and starts to tell you about you, right? This is the review. This is what people are saying. This is how I'm going to either give you a bonus or not. You receive that information. You say, bet. I'm going to be better next time so that I get that bonus. And so sometimes it's about being subjective and open to what other people are saying. So if it's not your spouse, if it's coming from friends, if it's coming from some outside community, it's more so about hearing, okay, this is something that I keep hearing over and over again. Am I really catastrophizing everything? Am I really the type of person that overdoes it or over exaggerates every situation? And if that's what you're constantly hearing, it's something to look into.
Absolutely. I hope that makes sense. And you know what? Also, that is why it's important. Why it is important to have wise counsel. Like if you have a small core, an inner core, a collective group of people that you seek wisdom from, guidance from, accountability from, sometimes shooting those ideas off with someone else can also allow you to know whether something's big or small, because it can't solely be determined by you either, because you may be in a certain situation or be in a certain emotional space where you're not properly perceiving what's going on. So for you, because you're hypervigilant, because you're dealing with stress, it seems like, oh my God, this is unbearable. This is unthinkable. And you need somebody to say, well, let's talk this through. Let's look at this through another filter. And that's why the power of community is so critically important. So I hope that makes sense. So another thing, here's a powerful one. You believe that everyone else is better off than you do. Don't we have a tendency of doing that? So we're in our relationship, they have better relationship than us. You're looking at your financial situation, man, they're doing so much better than us. You're thinking about the job that you're stuck in, man, I wish, you know, they seem to be doing well in their job. You think about your physical, yeah, they're doing well. You look through a filter of woe is me, what's wrong with me? Everybody else is enjoying life. Everybody else is doing their thing. And that reinforces so many negative feelings and emotions that you carry in your life. And it keeps you trapped and stuck in a low place. Yeah. You have to break out of that.
Yeah, you're victimizing yourself by comparison, right? Because we can always look on the other side of anything and stare at other people or their circumstances, what they have, and make assumptions. And really, that's what you're doing. You're making assumptions that somebody has it better than you, somebody knows more than you, somebody has more than you, and they're all assumptions, and you are victimizing yourself.
Here's a powerful one, Danielle, and I think that many people can relate to this. You attract people who are just like you. People who complain, people who blame, people who feel victimized by life. Now, so if you, they say this all the time, if you ever want to know who you are, take a close look at, or take a look at your five closest friends. You are the sum total of the people you hang around. And so think about it. What are people's situations like? What are their relational statuses like? What are their finances like? Where are they in life? You fit into that realm. So if you're around a bunch of people who are criticizing, who are complaining, who are woe is me, that's an indication that, man, there must be something inside of me that's attracting these type of people into my life. And as we heard before, misery loves company, right? Misery loves company. And people love sharing war stories. People love talking about what's wrong, what's going on. Girl, I can relate to that. Man, I'm going through the same situation. And so when you're...
It's comfortable.
Yep. And you never grow beyond your spot because you have other people who feed into your negative story and narrative.
Right there. So exactly. Like you're not going to ever grow above that barrel of crabs because guess what? It's comfortable. They want you in that barrel right along with them, complaining, going through in misery. So you've got to check your circle once in a while. I love that. Somebody said, word, check your circle once in a while, at least every decade, you got to go around and start looking around, maybe more frequently than that, right?
Probably.
And just start trimming and pruning those fringe relationships that are not serving you.
So listen, guys, I hope you're enjoying this session. We got a couple more that we want to hit. But before we do that, we want to go to a quick commercial break and talk to you about some things that are happening in the next couple of weeks that we're really excited about. So stay tuned. You're listening to the Couples Academy show. We'll be right back. See you soon. Yep, we're back. Hope that you're getting something out of this conversation. We're talking about the signs of a victim's mentality. Do you fit into the description? Is that you? Is there something that you need to change in your life to take your relationship up, to take your life up? That's why we're here. We want to become a mirror reflection of who you are and where you are in your life to get you unstuck so you can take your life to the next level.
Anthony Green says, remember, if you don't know who you are and what you stand for, others will define it for you and you may not like their answers. That's why it's essential that we take a personal inventory and do some self-examination. I couldn't agree with you more.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Self-examination, looking into the mirror. There's an exercise that I did some time ago called the mirror exercise. And I had to get bare in front of the mirror, and I had to assess myself, not just my physical body, but I had to look past what I visually saw, and I had to look at different areas of my life. And it was a hard reality because I wasn't where I thought I was. And so once you can have an honest conversation with yourself, you know, one of the challenges are it's difficult to have honest conversations with your spouse if you're not even having an honest conversation with yourself.
That's so true.
And listen, if you have a victim mentality, and who wants to admit, yeah, I'm a victim. I have a victim's mentality. So it's kind of like a loaded term. It's a hard pill to swallow to say that. But if you're struggling with doubts and fears and insecurities, and if you have a tendency of not taking responsibility for your situation and you have a woe is me attitude, you're looking at yourself through your own lenses, but something may be wrong with those lenses. You have to take those lenses off. And we say this all the time. You have to put on the goggles of God and you have to see yourself the way He sees you, because that's more of an accurate, fair description of who you really are. And so some of us are so low. Some of us live this woe is me lifestyle, and you don't have to do that. And we know that a life oftentimes is determined by one's mindset. You change your mindset, you change your life, and you ultimately change the world.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, so one of the other signs of a person who's struggling with a victim's mentality, you refuse to analyze yourself or improve your life.
Well, we just talked about that.
You
know, the refusal to even consider that something is wrong with you. This is when we start going into narcissistic personalities, which we talked about a couple of weeks ago, last week, where nobody can say anything wrong to you because it's too damaging to your own psyche. You are so damaged, so wounded, that you are unable to actually see yourself. We want to stay so far in that. And that is the ultimate victim mentality.
Are you someone who's constantly putting yourself down? Mm. That's a sign of a victim mentality. Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, you're beautiful, Danielle.
Thanks.
But if every time I say that, you're like, my eyes and my hair and my skin and my this and my that, like, you cannot accept.
Yeah.
You cannot accept that you're attractive, and you look at yourself as if you're ugly,
right,
or whatever it is. You're accomplished. You have a skill set, and everybody's just like, oh my God, you're so amazing. Oh no, it's on the, like, you just have a negative view and self-image. That is a sign that you're suffering from a victim's mentality. Now, you have to understand, if you have a negative mindset, you within yourself, about life, about yourself, about your ability, about your capability, about your potential, don't you think that that would have a negative impact on your marriage? Like, who wants to be around somebody?
Nobody. It's just like that movie, Why Did I Get Married, with Jill Scott, and I forget the other actor, where she was just complaining, like, you know, he would say, do you want to go get something to eat? And she would say, you know, I'm hungry, because she was heavier in the scene. And she was just always like self-deprecating and talking about herself. And he was like, you know what? I don't like it when you do that. Like, if you, I think you're perfect the way you are, but if there's something wrong for you, then do something about it. But please stop complaining, because nobody wants to be around somebody that is so low and woe is me. And always, they got to always pull them out of the trenches, right? You want to be around people that build you up. And it's like a back and forth thing. You build me up, I build you up. If every time we get together, I got to pull you out of the trenches, dust you off, make you feel good, that's a very parasitical relationship.
Absolutely. And who wants to be in a parasitical relationship? It's just not healthy. And so you want to change the trajectory of your life so that you change the direction of your marriage. Couple more comments. Wait, says, in Africa, we say, come sit on my back, brother, meaning you nailed it. Oh, wow. I love that. Saying, yes.
Come
yes.
sit on my back, brother.
Boom. You change your mindset. You change your life. Zay says that very, very, very true. Wow. Sum total of the people you hang around. Great reminder. I guess Kendra. Yep. There it is. There was another comment. Let's see. The Lord showed me that I had a martyr mentality in a particular area of my life. I looked into myself and realized how true it was. I'm allowing Him to work on me now.
Yes.
That's powerful. Oh, now, that's what I love good. About what you said, and that's a topic, the martyr mentality.
Yes. Thank you for that.
But you allow God to speak into you.
Yes.
You allow you. So in essence, there's three voices. You know, there's our voice, there's God, there's the devil. And oftentimes we're constantly listening to that devil voice or our own voice. But when we silence all of the noise and we allow that still small voice to speak clearly to us, and we're open to what the Spirit is saying, that is where true transformation comes.
Absolutely.
At the end of the day. So I love it. And many of us need to do more of that. And that requires a deepened relationship with God. See, when you have a true God consciousness and God identity, all of the idiosyncrasies and self-esteem issues and all of the negative mentality, all of that sheds off because that's not who he is.
You start reflecting him inside of you. And so it's a whole different kind of a boldness, not an arrogance boldness, but it's almost like a boldness in Christ, a boldness in who God created you to be, so that even though you still have certain weaknesses, because none of us get to shed them all, you get to walk through it with his boldness. And that's what carries you, instead of I'm this and I'm that, you know? And so, I'm not this and I'm not that.
Exactly. And so, guys, the key to your life, the key to your marriage is making God the foundation of your world. Because when you do that, he helps you to overcome the issues you're dealing with. He helps you to take your relationship to the next level. So, guys, we hope that you got something out of today. We hope that it was helpful for you. Really quickly, if you have not signed up, people are starting to sign up, which we're very excited about. But the Last Chance Weekend, it is the second weekend in December. It is our group virtual intensive. Listen, many of you are all over the world, but can't travel here to the United States. But so we created this event so that you could participate in. So we've had people in Australia. We've had people in London, Nigeria, South Africa, and different parts of the world, Egypt, Romania, who have decided to connect with Couples Academy. We want you to be a part of that. And so we plan on having an amazing time. It is the Last Chance Weekend. It is December the 11th through the 13th. You can go on the website and find out more information about that. But until then, guys, we hope that you have an amazing weekend. Actually, what am I talking about? It's Thursday. Tomorrow. There it is. But listen, we'll see you tomorrow, guys. Love you. This is the Couples Academy Show. I'm going to go to the next one.